For parents, having a baby can be an overwhelming experience, filled with excitement and nervousness. Some parents might find their baby being admitted to the neonatal intensive care unit, which by the name alone can add to their feelings of stress. Parents can find themselves confused about the reason for their newborn's admission, the interventions provided, opportunities for parental involvement in the baby's care, and the healthcare team involved. So let us demystify what happens in the NICU.
The most pressing question for parents and caregivers can be, why has a newborn baby been admitted into NICU? Admission of newborns into NICU often is the result of preterm delivery or delivery before 37 weeks of pregnancy. Another common reason for admission into NICU is low birth weight, or weight less than 5.5 pounds, which is often associated with preterm delivery. In the case of premature and low-weight babies, this often includes twins, triplets, or other pregnancies that involve multiple babies. The other causes of admission into NICU are health conditions, which include feeding problems, breathing complications, heart problems, infections, and birth defects. Incubators are one of the ways that premature or sick babies are treated in the NICU. Incubators are fully enclosed passive beds for the newborns and maintain a constant warm temperature in the environment with radiant warmers. In the case of open incubators, the incubator is open to the environment above, and closed incubators, on the other hand, have a closed environment. Closed incubators can isolate newborns from outside noises and protect newborns from airborne infectious particles and irritants. In the case of medical conditions such as jaundice, which is common in newborns, incubators can have special lights placed above for treatment. For parents, being separated from the newborns is hard, but incubators have side openings that allow parents to touch their newborns.
A reason for NICU admission for newborns that was highlighted was feeding problems. Babies admitted to the NICU can face problems with breastfeeding or bottle feeding due to improper sucking techniques. Premature babies that are also commonly admitted to the NICU often have gastrointestinal tracts that are not fully developed to carry out digestion. Furthermore, newborns can be provided care through equipment such as catheters, which are flexible tubes inserted into the belly button, and ventilators, which are machines used for assisted breathing, which can limit newborns from feeding properly. Let's look into how babies are provided with nutrition. Babies in the NICU receive vital fluids and essential nutrients through the following means. Parenteral nutrition means feeding intravenously through a vein. Parenteral means outside of the digestive tract, but it bypasses the entire digestive system. This way of nutrient delivery dominates the NICU as it minimizes the metabolic complications that interrupt normal growth. The terms intravenous nutrition and total parenteral nutrition, TPN, are terms used interchangeably. The infusion routes can be peripheral or central. Peripheral venous access limits the osmolality of fluids that can be infused through it. Central venous access can be through an umbilical venous catheter, or UVC, or a peripherally inserted central catheter, PICC. Once the inferior vena cava is located, blood will come out with ease. The position of the catheter can be confirmed with an X-ray, with termination of the tip at the junction of the superior vena cava and right atrium of the heart. These are ways in which they intake nutrients until they can take milk feedings. The contents include calories, proteins, fats, and electrolytes, which include sodium, potassium, and others. Each baby is assessed for its needs and have contents tailored accordingly. Their weight and urine amount are also tracked daily to account for any fluid needs. Ways in which babies are fed in the NICU include gavage or tube feedings. For premature babies younger than 32 to 36 weeks of gestation who cannot be fed from breast or bottle, flexible tube placed in baby's nostril or mouth and passed down into the stomach. Secondly, they can move on to cup or spoon feedings used in place of bottles for babies learning to feed in some NICUs. Then they move on to breastfeeding or nipple feedings. Babies can start practicing while still being tube-fed as soon as they are stable and able to suck well. Their development is gradual. Breastfeeding has all the nutrients needed for growth and development. Thus, there are certified lactation consultants or healthcare providers who are trained to help women with breastfeeding.
Kangaroo Care involves a skin-to-skin contact between the newborn infant and parent. It was originally introduced as a different approach to the standard NICU care of low birth weight infants due to overcrowded nurseries, limited and costly resources such as incubators, and high rates of neonatal infection and mortality. Kangaroo Care involves holding an infant typically in an upright position and with a swaddled infant on the chest of the parent, mainly done by the mother and other caregivers such as the father or family members. These sessions usually last 1 to 3 hours, during which cardiorespiratory and temperature monitoring of the infant is completed. In developed countries, skin-to-skin contact is seen as a complementary to incubator care and therefore is rare. However, this sort of care can help to humanize a medical experience, and thus hospitals have been motivated to implement it. Therefore, resource-rich countries use Kangaroo Care to ease the infant's transition to life outside the womb and encourage early bonding and breastfeeding. Additional benefits of the alternative NICU care have been proven. One study examined the relationship between Kangaroo Care and neonatal outcomes among infants of any birth weight or gestational age. The results of the study show that among newborns with low birth weights, Kangaroo Care was associated with a 36% lower mortality rate compared to standardized care. It was also indicated that there was a decreased risk of medical conditions such as neonatal sepsis, which is blood infections in infants, hypothermia, which is abnormally low body temperatures, and hypoglycemia, which is low blood sugar levels. Kangaroo Care was also associated with lower hospital readmission rates and increased exclusive breastfeeding. Finally, newborns that received these sessions had lower mean respiratory rates and pain measures, with higher oxygen saturation and body temperatures.
Procedures carried out. In order to work in the NICU, you can choose one of four career pathways, which includes neonatal nurse, neonatologist, dietitian, or respiratory therapist. Caregivers in the NICU undergo specialized training upon the completion of their undergraduate and graduate studies in order to achieve the ability to be able to work in the NICU. Parents can rest assured that their newborns are being cared for by a team of different professionals specialized in caring for their newborns. The second question for parents and caregivers can be, when is it time for the newborn to leave the NICU and go home? Well, discharge from the NICU is achieved if the admitted infant can adequately meet three milestones. First, the child must progress from an incubator or radiant warmer to an open crib, and they must be able to maintain their temperature and gain weight. The second requirement is undergoing a hearing test. There are two different types of hearing tests that can be administered. The first type is called autoacoustic emissions, which tests if the hair cells in the infant's ear are responding to sound. The second test is known as automated auditory brainstem responses, which shows that nerve cells are responding to sound input. These hearing tests are administered as the baby is stable in an open crib. The last test is known as a car seat test.
This test involves monitoring the oxygen level and heart rate of the infant over a 90-minute interval in which the child is placed in a car seat at a 45-degree inclination. In order to pass, the infant needs to show stability in oxygen level, heart rate, and body heat. If failed, the test will be readministered in 24 hours until the infant can go home.
The NICU can indeed be a challenging time for you and your loved ones, but be assured, quality and safe care will be provided for your baby so that they can be strong to head home. Was that too much information, and are you looking for a summary of everything we've mentioned? If so, head over to the link in the description below to access this infographic.